Welcome to the Old Church Theater. I know we're not there now, but it's where we want to be, to experience some homegrown theater in the company of friends. That was the plan when Leslie and Brian offered us the church stage for the first weekend in May. But then there was a pandemic. So what can you do? Well, this, it turns out. And this is a collaboration between the acting talents of Bill McMahon, Natalie Nolan, Margaret Rutan, and DJ Sproat. The narrating and sound engineer wizardry of Jerry Freyberg, all mixed in with some writing by Ian C. Feltham. We all want to thank Leslie Bonesteel and Brian Weston for supporting the arts in our community. We look forward to treading the boards at the old church again. But for now, it will be a virtual tread. Excuse me, that's my cue. Welcome, welcome. I am glad to see so many here this evening. Of course, all appropriately socially distanced at home with their families, but a great turnout nonetheless. Tonight, we'll be presenting the Toilet Trilogy, Ancient Greece to Absurdism. As the title suggests, we'll be presenting three plays. Each play takes its inspiration from a great work of theater, namely Antigone, King Lear, and Waiting for Godot. Of course, to present our interpretation of these three monumental works of theater, we've taken a few liberties and a few shortcuts, as well as adding a toilet to each play. You might consider that the toilet was added to provide a unifying theme, which connects the ancient with the modern, the royal with the pauper, representing a basic and universal characteristic of humanity. Or, it is just further evidence that our playwright is a tad unusual. I'm going with the latter. With that, let us begin. I want you to picture the stage at the old church, bare except a few scattered Ionic columns upstage and four wooden boxes. There are always wooden boxes. Piled downstage right. Antigone, late, begins late.
It is fairly quiet out there. Do you think we should start?
Well, of course we should start. That is what we do. We start the play. That is our purpose.
That's not what I meant. Where are the rest of them?
Well, the rest of whom?
The rest of the chorus. Sophocles said there were going to be 15 of us. That's what he always wants for his tragedies. 15.
Not this time. Only two. You and me.
Two of us? We can't be a chorus with just two.
Oh, sure we can.
Hello? You do know that we have to chant and dance. Sing odes and dance and narrate and dance.
So we dance. Big deal.
Big deal? I hate dancing. I always hide in the back.
Good luck with that.
What happened with the rest of the chorus? Eteocles, he never misses a gig.
Apparently, he had some bad moussaka from the street vendor down by the Lyceum. It wasn't pretty.
That guy? Everyone in Athens knows to steer clear of him, or they would be running to the latrine all week.
Hispanicopita ain't too bad.
You are braver than I. What about Achilles?
His heel. Again.
Yes, yes, the heel. He really should get that looked at.
Yeah, he saw some guy named Paris. Hasn't been the same since.
And the rest of them? Where are they?
Something about the Peloponnesian War.
Another war? Every time I turn around, Athens is fighting another war. Oh, who are we fighting this time?
The Peloponnesians?
Right. And does Sophocles know about this?
About the Peloponnesians?
No, smartass. About the chorus, or lack thereof.
I decided to keep him out of it. He would just throw a fit and write another tragedy.
Well, who died and made you Zeus?
Yeah, well, that makes no sense. How can someone die and make me Zeus? The gods are
immortal. Yes, I get it.
You know, I heard a good joke about Zeus the other day.
Don't start in with the Zeus jokes. It never ends well.
No. Listen, this is a good one.
Here we go.
What does Zeus wear under his robe?
I don't know. What does Zeus wear under his robe?
Thunderwear! Get it? Thunderwear? God of thunder?
Every time. Will you ever learn?
Maybe we should start.
Well, do you think? But where is Antigone?
She is late.
Would you blame her? It doesn't turn out great for her.
That's her now.
What is she doing?
Moving boxes, I think. She seems bored.
She seems uncomfortable to me.
Well, I expect she would be. Creon has locked her in a cave to die. Things aren't going too well for her.
She is in the cave already? Are we that far along in the play? Well, what about Ismene? Creon? Haman? The sentry?
They all went home.
Went home?
Why, Antigone was late.
Hello? Anyone out there?
I think she heard us.
Is that you, Ismene? My darling sister? Hello?
Well, answer her.
No, you answer her.
Who said that?
It is us.
Us?
The chorus.
Oh, the chorus. It doesn't sound like much of a chorus to me.
I know. That is what I said. Only two of us, if you can believe it.
Two? What happened to the rest of them?
Well, most of them went off to the Peloponnesian War.
Another war.
I hear you, sister. And then there was Achilles.
The heel.
I know, right? Eteocles ate some bad moussaka.
Moussaka?
Yeah, he got it from that guy by the Lyceum.
Oh.
You know him. Sells it from his donkey cart. I bet you even the donkey won't touch it. That guy.
You have the two of us. We are the chorus. All right. You should be lucky to have us.
Lucky? I am trapped in a cave and condemned to die.
Well, that is hardly our fault. If you'd listened to Creon and didn't go and try to bury your brother, Polynices, you might not have been in this predicament.
Hold on there. She was just following the laws of God, showing the proper respect for her brother.
A brother who was a traitor to the Thebes.
Traitor? Well, that is matter of opinion. Creon made the rules to suit him, and he refused to listen to reason.
You have a point. And he will pay for his stubbornness.
Well, it is a Greek tragedy, so there has to be a body count.
Polynices, Eteocles, Haman,
Eurydice,
and
Antigone.
Like they say, the gods who drive the hearse seldom shove it in reverse.
Hey, that's good. Is that yours?
I wish. Morris Sagoff. Shrinklets.
I haven't read that one.
Yeah, I think you would like it. It has...
Hello? I am the one dying here.
Weird flex, but okay.
What?
Weird flex, but okay. It is what the people say.
Not the people of the bees.
I think that, as the chorus, we are in a much better position to know what the people of Thebes are saying.
I agree. So it is unanimous.
Unanimous? There are just two of you. You don't represent the people of Thebes. You are not even a chorus. Two? Ha! Pathetic.
Well, we are all you've got. So get used to it.
And you think you represent Thebes? Your father, Oedipus, killed his own father and then married his mother. How messed up is that?
Yeah, then your brother kills your other brother.
And you go and disown your sister because she won't help you bury one of your brothers.
And your sister is really your aunt.
I think half aunt.
No, full aunt. Her grandmother's daughter.
But she is also her father's daughter.
So where does the half come into it?
Oh, I don't know. I was just splitting the difference. You see, in my family, my grandfather married my grandmother, but then he decided to marry her sister as well. And then my father married his first cousin, who is also his half-sister, and then...
You know, Antigone, perhaps you're right. You are a proper Theban. Anyway, Let's get on with the play.
Yes, I mean, it's almost finished. You nearly missed your own death.
I couldn't help it. I think that moussaka wasn't very...
Yeah. Now, where are we anyway?
I think it's the cave scene. Should I start?
Yes, we will all be dead if we have to wait for her.
You went too far, the last limits of daring, smashing against the high throne of justice. Your life's in ruins, child. I wonder, do you pay for your father's terrible ordeal?
There, at last you've touched it. The worst pain, the worst anguish. Raking up grief for father three times over, for all the doom that struck us down, the brilliant house of Laius. Oh, mother, your marriage bed, the coiling horrors, the coupling there. You, with your own son, my father, doom struck mother. Such were my parents, and I their wretched child. I go to them now, cursed, unwed, to share their home. I am a stranger. Oh, dear brother, doomed in your marriage murders mine. Your dying drags me down to death alive.
Reverence asks some reverence in return, but attacks on power never go unchecked, not by the man who holds the reins of power. Your own blind will, your passion, has destroyed you.
No one to weep for me, my friends, no wedding song. They take me away in all my pain. The road lies open, waiting. Never again. The law forbids me to see the sacred eye of day. I am agony. No tears for the destiny that's mine. No loved one mourns my death.
And that's it. She's gone.
It looks that way.
Are you sure?
Yep, I'm pretty sure.
Moussaka. What is it with theater these days? Everyone is staying home.
I don't blame them. It's all the same old stuff. Humans break some law, gods aren't happy. Human goes, oops, my mistake. Gods are, sorry, too late. All Hades breaks loose. Humans learn their lesson. Not.
I know, and the gods can do as they please because, well, they are gods.
Tell me about it. Zeus, when he isn't tossing thunderbolts around, he's binding people to stones.
Or making them roll stones up the hill again and again and again.
Or he's always stepping out on his wife Hera, turning into a bull and seducing Europa.
And then there was the swan thing with Leda. Poor Hera. What she has to put up with.
Don't mind Hera. He turned his first wife into a fly and ate her.
He ate his first wife?
Not only that, she was pregnant with Athena at the time, so Hephaestus had to pull her out from his head to deliver her.
And there is Olympus looking down on us. They should take a look at themselves first, if you ask me.
But they're not going to ask us, are they?
We are just mere mortals.
Just the chorus.
We are not even the chorus.
Are you two quite finished?
Who is that?
Who do you think it is?
Zeus? It's Zeus! Do you think he heard us just now?
I don't know. He probably wasn't listening. He's a busy guy. I mean, God.
Of course I heard you. I am Zeus. I hear everything.
Everything? That must get confusing.
It's a God thing. Anyway, I only listen to the good parts.
Oh?
And with you two, there aren't any good parts. Now, get out of here before I turn you both into an endless plate of moussaka. Coming and going.
Yikes!
Just leaving. Let's get out of here.
I'm fed up with that dribble from Sophocles. The next one is more my style.
That would be the throne.
Who are you?
I am the narrator. I represent the omniscient voice leading the listener through the story, setting the scene, providing some context to what will follow.
Well, I knew that.
You will also know that we're in the washroom of a nursing home. There is a solo white toilet on the stage and a door just to the left.
Yeah, I knew that too.
We will soon be joined by Mr. Lear, an elderly gentleman dressed in a long, flowing, regal-looking nightgown.
He's quite good, I hear.
The actor? Yes, quite exceptional. In fact, he...
Get on!
Yes, of course. We see Mr. Lear sitting on his toilet, just as his three daughters, Sylvie, Nancy, and Delia, are about to arrive in his room. They are here to...
That is enough.
Enough? But I haven't finished setting the... I think you get the picture.
Blow, winds, and crack your cheeks. Rage! Blow! Your cataracts and hurricane overflow until you have drenched our steeples, drowned the cots, you sulfurous and thought executing fires, fall couriers of your cleaving thunderbolts, singe my hair! And now, all shaking thunder, strike flat the thick rotunding of the earth, that nature's molds all germane spill at once. That makes ungrateful man. Nothing! Nurse! Nurse! Oh, keep me in temper. I would not be mad. Is there anyone out there? Nurse!
We are here.
Who's that?
It is us, Father, your daughters.
Good! My own flesh and blood to comfort an aging father. Come in here and help me up.
We were waiting until you were, finished.
Finished? You can't finish what has never started. Now get in here and give the old man a hand.
I'm not sure we should go in there. I mean, I don't have the requisite training.
Well, can't we get the nurse? I mean, it's her job. Yeah, I'll text her.
Oh, it's probably change of shift. It is always change of shift. I mean, this is what we're paying for. This? Pathetic.
Good God. Coming, Father.
Delia, my baby girl. So full of spring helpless old man, too near winter that he may not escape the freeze-up this year.
Careful, Father! What are you doing, Delia? You should have waited for the nurse. Nurse!
Never mind, Sylvie. She was trying to help. Besides, I think I might need to stay here a while anyway.
Father, really?
No. No false alarm. And what good fortune has brought us all together today?
Father, we already talked about this. The cottage. We were going to discuss the cottage.
Yes. Yes, yes. What about the cottage?
We have to make some decisions, remember? As your POA... Your power of attorney. I believe that...
How long have I been in here?
You moved in 6 months ago, remember, Father? After Mother died.
Not in the home! How long have I been on this toilet?
Well, I don't know that. Where is the nurse?
Are you feeling all right, Father? You look uncomfortable.
Of course I am uncomfortable! I am bloody miserable! Abandoned! That's how I feel!
You were not abandoned, Father. You know moving here was the right thing to do.
Abandoned here on my throne, nurse!
Let me rub your back, Father. Do you like the daisies I have brought? You always liked daisies.
What, daisies? Your mother liked daisies.
And peonies. She would send me into the garden to cut them to put on the table. And you would shake out the ants.
Oh, that was so gross. I hate ants.
Mother would shout at you. Get those bugs off the table. We have to eat dinner there.
Well, someone had to be the grown-up. Mother kept things in order.
But you wouldn't let her kill them. We had to brush them onto the dustpan and out the door. Do you remember, Father?
Oh, I can feel them crawling on me.
What, daisies? Your mother liked daisies.
Now, Father, we need to discuss what has to happen with the cottage.
We had great times at that cottage. Great times. Tell me a story, each of you, about why you love the cottage so much. We will start with you, Sylvie.
Now, Father? Here? Well, I remember when we launched the cabin cruiser that you had built. You worked so hard on that boat, steaming the planks to ply the wood and attach it with brass screws. The same screws you used to put on the nameplate. Sylvie, I was so proud you had named it after me.
You were my firstborn, and I loved that boat. It was the sleekest on the lake. Now, Nancy, tell me why you loved the cottage.
It was a fast boat, too. I remember when you would take me water skiing. We were such a good team together, you and I, especially with the slalom racing. And the rooster tails I would spray up when we whipped by the Cornwall's dock, and you would laugh so loud. And you were so proud of the medals I would win.
Oh, you were unbeatable, Nancy.
I believe it was I who taught you how to water ski, and if memory serves, I won the first medal behind that boat. Isn't that correct, Father?
Oh, you were good, Sylvie. True enough.
Yeah, but I won the most.
Well, I didn't have the time to waste being out on the lake. I had to manage the gardens and repair the deck. Jeremy and I painted the cottage.
Hold on. When Scott stayed, he would help too.
Help himself to the beer, maybe. Though he did light the barbecue once. It was good we had that extra fire insurance added, wasn't it, Father?
Yes, yes, I suppose so. And now, my lovely Delia, tell your father how much the cottage has meant to you.
It is your cottage, Father. I enjoyed it as any child would. No more and no less.
That's it?
I was never one to compete. I just want to make things simple for you, Father. I can't find words to win your affection. My heart knows it is there, and that's enough.
You have nothing more to say?
Nothing.
Then it is nothing you will get.
You know, Father, that I don't seek anything. I have been away at school, and now I am off to study in France in the fall. I won't be around to use the cottage.
Let France have you. You are not my daughter. I would have been better if you weren't born than to have treated me so poorly.
Father, I have always tried to be truthful with you, but I will leave if that will give you peace. I am sure my sisters will look after you.
Sweet Delia, now shunned by her father, kneels down on the stage in front of him, presenting her back as a table for her sisters to sign her inheritance away.
Sylvie, you and Nancy can do with the cottage as you see fit.
As you wish, Father. In fact, I had the papers prepared by the lawyer. If you can sign them, I will, as your POA, make sure your wishes are respected.
Yes. Yes.
Right here. And here. Initial here. And here, where her name has been crossed out. And here again.
There it is done. Now you both have the cottage.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father.
Good. Now, can I get out of this place?
Wait for the nurse, Father. I will call her. Nurse!
Not the bathroom woman out of this place!
This place?
This lockup I've been doing time in. The home, this blasted nursing home. No, I don't know why they call it that, because you can never find a nurse. Now, I can spend half my time with you and half my time with Nancy. And in the summer, we can all stay at the cottage.
Yes. Well, Father, it isn't going to work out like that. You see, Father, you have a lot of needs that we can't really look after. Now, can we?
Needs? What needs?
Well, Father, there is this, isn't there? Well, perhaps we could work out something at another time.
Now?
No, not now. I have a personal training session with Eddie this aft. No, it will have to be...
A personal training session with Eddie. Eddie Gloucester?
Yes. We have been working out for quite some time now. He is very good.
Yeah, I know he's very good because we have been working out also for quite a long time. In fact, we have a personal training session this aft as well at 4 p.m.
Well, our session is at 3 p.m. I hope he won't be all worn out by the time he gets to you. Of course, you could always try and get Scott to light a fire under you instead.
Well, I'm thinking that Scott could do quite a few more push-ups than your Jeremy.
I don't care if he can. I'm working out with Eddie, after all. Oh, I'm late. Can't keep Eddie waiting.
Sylvie! I am going to kill you!
Nothing! Is there anyone there? Nurse!
Yes, Mr. Lear, what is wrong?
There's nothing!
There is nothing wrong?
No, I need help!
What is the problem?
I've been abandoned! Help me!
Yes, Mr. Lear. I will be in soon and we will get you back to bed. It is time for your medications now.
Nurse. You see me here, you gods. A poor old man as full of grief as age, wretched in both. If it be you that shares these daughters' hearts against their father, foam me not so much to bear it tamely. Touch me with noble anger, and let not woman's weapons, water drops, stain my man's cheeks. No, you unnatural hags. I fear I am not in my perfect mind. Oh, let me not be mad, not mad, sweet heaven. Infirmity doth still neglect my all office. Whereto our health is bound. We are not ourselves when nature, being oppressed, commands the mind to suffer with the body.
Oh, my dear father, restoration hang thy medicine on my lips, and let this kiss repair those violent harms that my two sisters have in thy reverence made.
You do me wrong. To take me out of the grave, thou art a soul in bliss. But I am bound upon a wheel of fire that mine old tears do scald like molten lead. Delia, you're back? Are you back from France?
It is okay, Father. I haven't left for France. You were dreaming.
You will stay. You will stay with me now.
No, Father, I must go. It is what I have to do. I love you, Father.
Nurse!
Nurse! Nurse! Nurse! Nurse!
And that is the first act. Now, during this brief interval, you can stretch your legs, refill your glasses, and maybe go to the toilet. After all, that does seem to be the theme. I'll be back in 30 seconds with our last play. Welcome back. I hope everyone is suitably refreshed. Our next play, Waiting for Godot to Go, draws from Samuel Beckett's play, Waiting for Godot. Beckett's work has been famously described as a play where nothing happens twice. As we've condensed things to one act, that aphorism is only half true. Beckett relied on a very visual expression of his work, so I'll have my work cut out for me. The stage is set with a generically labeled public washroom door, looming upstage center. The door is closed. There's a collection of wooden boxes, always with the boxes, situated downstage right. One character, Poutine, is hidden behind these boxes. Another character, Turmeric, enters from stage left. She's disheveled and wearing a Hawaiian shirt and shorts, with flip-flops. She walks tentatively across the stage, with a mixture of looking for someone or something. Intermittently, one of her flip-flops comes off her foot, and she walks a few steps before she notices this, and then looks with some urgency for the missing footwear. She finds it and resumes her search. Again, she loses the flip-flop, and again walks without it for a bit with a noticeable limp. She continues to limp, and then spies the flip-flop. She stops. She ignores it, and continues to walk with a limp. She stops. She looks back at the missing flip-flop, and then at her foot. She continues to walk with a limp. She stops. She has a look of someone who needs to go to the washroom. She looks at the door, with the washroom sign. She looks at her foot. She looks at the missing flip-flop. She hesitates. She steps toward the flip-flop, but then stops. She looks at the bathroom door. She looks at her foot. She looks at the flip-flop. She looks toward the audience. She looks at her foot. She looks at the audience. She looks at the flip-flop. She looks at the bathroom door. She heads to the flip-flop and puts it on. She looks at the audience. The urge hits her again, and she heads back to the door. She loses one of her flip-flops. She walks with a limp. She walks almost to the bathroom door and realizes the flip-flop is missing, and she looks at her foot. She rests her hand on the doorknob. Poutine arises from her concealed area stage right. She's wearing dress pants, suspenders, dark tie, and a lumberjack shirt. Poutine slouches to sit on a box far stage right and looks off into space and not addressing anyone in particular.
It is the same again. Us together.
Turmeric is slightly startled and pulls her hand from the doorknob, looks at Poutine, and turns from the door and limps toward finding her flip-flop.
What is the matter with your foot?
Nothing. It is my shoe that keeps falling off.
Typical.
Typical? It is not. They usually stay on.
Typical that one would blame the ailments of her foot on her shoe.
Because there is nothing wrong with my feet.
Yet you walk with a limp.
That is because I've lost my shoe. If I remove the second one, you see, there is no limp. Ow! Oh, my toe! Oh, I am tired. Pass me my shoes, Poo-Poo.
My friend, you are weary. Where did you sleep?
On a beach, on a sidewalk, in a forest, in a ditch. I don't know. I don't remember.
Are you hurt?
Not badly.
You weren't beaten?
What?
When you were in the ditch, did they beat you?
Well, no. No, not this time. It is my toe that hurts.
At least it acknowledges you.
Well, it is my toe. Of course it acknowledges me.
It is not of course. Your toe acknowledges you. Fine, Tutu. Yes, that is fine. It acknowledges you.
Do not your toes acknowledge you?
I know that they are there.
Well, that seems good.
Do they know that I am here?
Is that important?
To be unsure if you exist? Is that important? Is it important?
We are still talking about your toes.
If I was paralyzed, I would ache for their recognition. If they were amputated, I would be haunted by them.
They are just your toes.
It is not just my toes. My entire body doesn't acknowledge that I exist. My heart beats. That is all.
Well, that would seem enough.
It is ambivalent. It beats.
It beats. This is good. This is...
But my brain is not ambivalent. It insists on arguing with me. Always the same endless argument that starts nowhere and leads nowhere and ends nowhere.
Is it always nowhere?
Always.
But here we are.
Again.
Like yesterday.
There is a silence now between these two. They both pace about the stage in silence. Turmeric stops as if to ask a question. Then reconsiders and continues to pace. Then she does it again. And reconsiders. Finally, she stops and awkwardly gestures toward Poutine's, genital region.
And your...
Your...
No, your... You know...
Turmeric discreetly gestures at the door of the washroom with the male-female figure, then looks at Poutine and then to her, crotch.
Ah!
Are they ambivalent?
They have left.
Left?
They have left.
Left? You no longer have any parts? Where did they go?
It wasn't that they had run away. That would imply decision and purpose and action. No, they moved out. Nothing dramatic, just quietly packed up and left.
Are they coming back?
My body parts are like roommates. They pay rent, they leave dishes in the sink. Sometimes I know they have been here and sometimes not. We rarely talk.
My body is speaking to me now. I forgot to go and...
She heads toward the washroom door, but before she touches the handle...
Wait!
I can't wait!
We must wait.
Wait? What are we waiting for? I have got to go.
Waiting for Hugo.
Hugo?
Hugo.
I have got to go.
She lets go of the door handle and resigns from her bathroom quest.
Is he coming?
I don't know. We have to wait.
Was he here yesterday?
Were we here yesterday? In this spot?
Yes.
Did he come?
No.
We must.
Wait.
Wait.
What if he doesn't come?
He will come.
What if he doesn't?
We will come tomorrow.
And wait.
He will come.
If we wait?
If we wait.
Did he say today?
I don't know.
Did you make a note?
I don't make notes.
If you made a note, you would know.
If I made a note, I would lose it.
If you kept the note, you would know.
I don't make notes because I lose notes. Keeping notes that I don't make would serve no purpose.
We would know if we should...
Wait.
Wait.
While we wait, we should drown ourselves.
Where?
In the toilet!
But you can't swim.
And that's the point.
Poutine jumps up and runs toward the washroom door. And just as she reaches for the door handle...
Well, I can swim.
She lets go.
Don't. Let's do nothing. It's safer.
We will wait to see what he says.
Who says?
Hugo.
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 I would like to know where he stands.
Or sits on the subject.
Or the object, if he does.
When he comes.
If he does.
Today.
Or tomorrow.
I doubt he will come.
Doubt?
Yes.
How can you doubt?
We are here and he isn't.
But he said he would come.
I doubt it.
We are here.
I am not as convinced anymore.
We are on a point. We have exact coordinates. He is on a point with exact coordinates. There is a line that joins us.
Not if we don't exist.
You doubt we exist?
Why not?
Why not? Maybe because I can see you.
Well, that proves nothing. It could be an illusion. I doubt the past as I wasn't there. I doubt the future as it may never come. I doubt authority. I doubt conformity. I doubt everything.
You cannot doubt that you are doubting.
I am tired.
You cannot doubt that you smell badly.
I doubt my senses.
Why did you do that?
You stink, therefore I can.
I must go.
Go where?
I must go now.
Turmeric heads to the washroom and then... Turmeric and Poutine scramble over each other to hide behind the boxes, stage right.
What was that?
A cart?
The cart?
Descartes!
Entering along the center aisle behind the audience, we find two unusual characters. Crudel leads the way. He's an older man dressed much like a hobo. He's holding a small book that is open, and he is mumbling out loud.
As I can see, and oh, yeah.
As Crudel marches forward, a long chain attached to his trousers drags behind him. At the end of that chain is Notso. She is properly attired in a pinstripe suit with a bowler hat. She has a folded canvas stool under her right arm, a leather satchel draped across her shoulder, and in her left hand there is a small hand drum. I suppose you might call it a boron. It is certainly not a tambourine. Crudel proceeds forward to the stage as Turmeric and Poutine cower behind the boxes. The tension on the chain rises, and Crudel stops and looks up from his book.
Fool!
Notso starts to move along the aisle toward Crudel and begins a dirge-like beat with the drum. And one, and two, and three, and four. They both ascend onto the stage and march in small circles with the chain dragging behind.
The Peloponnesians took two sophists by their slippery throat. Protagoras was first to look, light blue from democratic votes. That Sparta with laconic grips would have abandoned on a hill, and Helen and her thousand ships could not prevent that blood to spill. Fool! Fool!
Notso returns and pulls a long handkerchief from her inner jacket pocket and sweeps the top of the stool. She then takes two steps away towards the center and pauses. Crudel sits on the stool and opens the book he was reading from. He looks down at it. He squints his eyes. He looks up again. Turmeric and Poutine peer out from their hiding place.
Is that him?
Who?
Hugh.
Hugh.
Fool!
Crudel is straining to read the book. Notso walks towards Crudel and takes out a pair of glasses with the lenses blackened out. She gently places them on Crudel. She then takes two paces towards the center and pauses.
Is it him?
Nor would that virtue could be taught, courage, justice, and temperance, and eyes and ears that will be bought, wisdom and unwieldy dance.
Well?
Well?
Hugh!
Hugh! Go!
I am not going. Hugo.
Hugo?
Is it not him? Is it?
Hugo?
Hugo.
I have to go!
Poor Turmeric. Overcome by nature's call, she creeps behind Crudel and heads toward the washroom. As her hand reaches the doorknob...
Fool!
not so, steps toward Crudell, and with aplomb, she leans forward and turns the page in the book that Crudell is reading. She then takes 2 paces away towards the center and pauses. Turmeric watches this incredulously. She looks at Crudell. She looks at Notso. She looks at Poutine. She looks at the door. She starts to turn the handle, but then Poutine...
Tutu!
...rushes forward.
What?
Ask him.
What?
Him.
Who?
You.
Hugh?
No, you. Go.
Hugo?
Yes, Hugo.
No, Hugo!
Turmeric now knows what she must do. She timidly approaches Notso.
Excuse me, ma'am?
No response.
Ms. Fool?
Am I to understand that you, a personage with whom I have never herewith been acquainted, does didn't to refer to me as a fool?
Well,
Well, you see, ma'am, we overheard that fellow just there calling you fool, so we figured it must be your name.
Which fellow?
That fellow, Hugo.
Hugo?
Hugo.
I believe you are referring to Crudell.
Crudell?
Crudell.
He calls you a fool.
Well, of course. He suffers from a profound lack of basic education, and consequently is woefully deficit in a reasonable understanding of common courtesy.
Georgia's speech could not be heard. Flattery lost, and an unfurled sail. Knowledge spoken without a word, and whispers, but doomed to fail.
He reads well enough.
Reads well enough? My good woman, Crudell cannot read. How could he possibly read? Firstly, he does not possess the basic intellectual rudiments for such an endeavor. And secondly, he is profoundly blind.
Fool!
Notso heads toward Crudell and turns a page.
Fool!
Notso takes off the glasses, takes her handkerchief and wipes the lenses clean, and replaces them on Crudell's head. She then takes 2 paces away towards the center and pauses.
Did you see that he is blind?
If you both are whispering, in deference to Crudell's emotive disposition, I can assure you that this is wholly unnecessary. Firstly, he has no capacity to comprehend the range of complexity that is found in nuanced human discourse. And secondly, he is profoundly deaf.
He is not what I would call lucky.
You know, my brother?
I do.
You do?
Lucky.
I am?
You are.
My brother.
I am not.
He is not.
My brother is lucky.
Turmeric eyes the chain binding Notso to Crudell.
And you are not so?
Lucky.
Correct. With a K.
Ah, yes.
Turmeric, silly girl, reaches forward to grab the chain hanging between Notso and Crudell and starts to make a knot with it.
Notso, with a K.
That tug on the chain has caught Crudell's attention. Crudell stands up suddenly to approach Poutine and Turmeric. They instinctively hug each other in fear. Crudell now circles around these two, wrapping them tighter with each pass.
Our dialogue on shoulders broad, Socratic questions never heard. You go now blind and ride roughshod on truth and virtue long interred.
Crudell stops and looks up towards the audience. Turmeric and Poutine are tied together. They look at each other. They glance over towards Crudell. They look at the audience. Turmeric looks at her bladder and squirms slightly.
Oh, poo-poo. I have to go.
Then I have to go too. Too.
They both look at each other. They glance over to Crudell. They look at the audience. They give a little hop together to the left. They stop. They both turn to look at Crudell. They look forward to the audience, and then...
Did he see us?
Did he hear us?
Now Notso circles our 2 bound friends.
Crudell has a very keen sense of smell.
That would not be necessary to catch wind of you, Poutine.
Ha! It is not me who forgot to go.
You know, it was you who forgot the soap.
Again, Notso circles.
He can smell despair.
I don't sleep in ditches.
I have all my body parts.
One more turn.
He can smell discontent.
I have all my dignity.
You don't have Hugo.
He will come, if not today.
He can smell fear.
The unwinding is complete, and Turmeric and Poutine are free, but are unaware.
If not today, tomorrow?
Fool!
Turmeric and Poutine hug each other as Notso goes to Crudel. She removes the glasses and places them in the inner pocket of her jacket. She takes the book from Crudel and places it in the leather satchel. Notso then heads off stage. Crudel follows as the chain tightens and our visitors have gone.
Will they be back?
Turmeric sits on the vacant stool.
I am tired, Poo-Poo.
Tomorrow?
I am tired today.
We will have to wait.
Again, it is such hard work.
To wait? At least you have a stool.
Well, it is not my stool. Otherwise, I would give it to you.
You are kind, Tutu, even if you do smell.
If we didn't smell...
It would be pleasant.
If we didn't hear...
It would be serene.
If we didn't see...
Would we be seen?
Turmeric and Poutine stand and look at each other for a long time. Turmeric turns her head to look at the washroom door. She turns back to look at Poutine and then looks at her bladder.
I have got to go.
Turmeric rushes towards the washroom door and then...
Happy birthday to me. To me. To me.
A person leaves the washroom and closes the door behind. She steps forward on the stage and stops. She is aware she's being observed by Turmeric, by Poutine. She returns their gaze and points toward the washroom door.
Hugo? In there? You might regret it.
The person leaves. Poutine and Turmeric look at each other. They look at the washroom door. They reach for the doorknob. They stop. They look at each other.
Hugo? In there?
You might regret.
Poutine sits on the stool. She is tired.
Regret it. Until tomorrow?
Turmeric lies down at Poutine's feet. She is tired.
Hugo. Wait until?
Tomorrow.
Tomorrow.
They fall asleep. Until tomorrow. You've been listening to a series of plays for the stage of the imagination. The Toilet Trilogy, Ancient Greece to Absurdism. Antigone, Late the Throne. Waiting, Forgot to Go, by Ian C. Feltham. Presented in collaboration with the Old Church Theater. The cast in order of appearance. Narrator, Jerry Fraber. Antigone Late. Chorus 1, Margaret Rattan. Chorus 2, DJ Sproat. Antigone, Natalie Nolan. Zeus, Bill McMahon. The Throne, Lear, Bill McMahon. Sylvie, Margaret Rattan. Nancy, DJ Sproat. Delia, Natalie Nolan. Waiting, Forgot to Go. Turmeric, DJ Sproat. Poutine, Natalie Nolan. Crudel, Bill McMahon. Notso, Margaret Rattan. Person, Hannah Feltham. Sound engineering by Jerry Fraber. Special thanks to Leslie Bonesteel and Brian Weston of the Old Church Theater. We hope to gather again soon to share stories in person. But until then, stay safe, stay home, and wash your hands.